Please help me open today's session with a moment of silent meditation, and please allow me to offer a prayer. After I finish that prayer, I'll be concluding it with the Serenity Prayer, at which time feel free to join me. God, thank you for allowing us to come together and pray in this way. Thank you for providing us a place that we can come together. We would like to thank you, God, for those beautiful 12 steps. And thank you for allowing each and every one of us for being sober during this day. We humbly ask for your guidance, care, wisdom, direction, and love as we walk through these steps today. And God, please set aside everything that we think we know about ourselves, the book, sobriety, the steps, and you, God. And God, please help each and every one of us to have an open mind today so that we may have a new experience and discover the truth. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. I'm Paul Fisher, and I'm an alcoholic. And I'd like to welcome everyone to the fourth session of the Big Book Workshop, where we are taking the 12 steps as outlined in the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous so that we may experience freedom from our alcoholism. Today we're going to be covering steps 10, 11, and 12. Let's turn to page 59. Step 10, continue to take personal inventory, and when we were wrong, promptly admitted it. Okay, let's move to page 84, where step 10 begins. We're going to go to page 84, paragraph 2. That's page 84, paragraph 2, where the authors say, this thought brings us to step 10, which suggests we continue to take personal inventory and continue to set right any new mistakes as we go along. We vigorously commence this way of living as we cleaned up the past. We have entered the world of the Spirit. So, if I'm actively making my amends, this is what I will experience. I will have entered the world of the Spirit. Our next function is to grow in understanding and effectiveness. This is not an overnight matter. It should continue for our lifetime. Continue to watch for selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. When these crop up, we ask God at once to remove them. We discuss them with someone immediately and make amends quickly if we have harmed anyone. Then we resolutely turn our thoughts to someone we can help. Love and tolerance of others is our code. What I find beautiful about this paragraph is that the author has given me specific instructions on how to do a daily 10 step. If you look back at the beginning of this paragraph, it says, we continue to take personal inventory and continue to set right any new mistakes as we go along. No mention of at the end of the day when I retire, but as I go along. In other words, a 10th step is something I'm going to practice during the day. And the authors give us specific instructions here. They show us how to carry out four spiritual practices. The first one is watch. If you go down eight lines in that paragraph, it says continue to watch for selfishness, dishonesty, resentment, and fear. Have you ever been to the mall and people watch? Or go to the park and you people watch? You don't interact with those people. You simply observe. That's what watching means. If you want to have a new experience, try practicing watching for a mere 30 days. Simply watch you. That doesn't mean I analyze what I do. I'm just simply observing. So I'm watching for four things. And then the authors instruct me what to do when this occurs. It says, when these crop up, we ask, that's a prayer, we ask God at once to remove them. So if they crop up, at once I'm going to ask God to remove them. immediately following, it says we discuss them with someone immediately and make amends quickly if we have harmed anyone. That means I'm going to discuss it with somebody that day before I go to bed. And it also says, and make amends quickly if we have harmed anyone. So you see, I have this spot check that inventory I can do during the day where I can make amends immediately. Then it goes on to say, then we resolutely turn our thoughts to someone we can help. So isn't that beautiful? We have four spiritual practices that we can do during the day. Watch, ask, discuss, and turn. Now what we have in the next paragraph are called the 10-step promises. Now this is providing that I've done everything up to this point, meaning I've had a first step experience, I found a power greater than me, I made a decision to give my life to that God, I did an inventory, shared it with another person, took the exact nature of my wrongs to God in 6 and 7, compiled my harm list from my inventory, began making my amends, and began practicing the 10-step during the day. Check out the magnitude of these guarantees as we read on. And we have ceased fighting anything or anyone, even alcohol. Wow. Would you like to be able to stop fighting anything or anyone? Does that sound cool or what? For by this time, sanity will have returned. I am guaranteed to experience what the author's experienced. That has been my personal experience. I've also had the experience of not experiencing these promises when I don't do the work. We will seldom be interested in liquor. If tempted, we recoil from it as from a hot flame. We react sanely normally. Wow. React sanely normally. That's so foreign to me. And when we will find that this has happened, check this out. And we will find that this has happened automatically. It doesn't say that I'm making it happen. We will see that our new attitude, there's that word again, new. New attitude. Not attitude, but new attitude. That means different than it was before. Toward liquor has been given us without any thought or effort on our part. In other words, I'm not making it happen. All I'm simply doing is I'm just simply doing the footwork. It just comes. That is the miracle of it. We're not fighting it. Neither are we avoiding temptation. We feel as though we have been placed in a position of neutrality, safe and protected. Am I in a position of neutrality? Do I feel safe and protected? We have not even sworn off. Instead, the problem has been removed. It does not exist for us. We're neither cocky nor are we afraid. That is our experience. Then they go on to tell us that is how we react so long as we keep in fit spiritual condition. They're giving us a little checklist. It has been my experience, personally, as well as observing people I've worked with through the years in these rooms, that there's fundamentally only one reason why I will drink again. And that's because I'm not in fit spiritual condition. If I am in fit spiritual condition, it is impossible for me to drink. My God will not let it happen. Ask yourself, well, how am I going to know if I'm in fit spiritual condition? They just got through telling us. This is how we react. So I have a little checklist. Let's see if I'm in fit spiritual condition. I go back and I start reading the beginning of that paragraph. Have I ceased fighting anything or anyone? Or am I getting into arguments with people all the time? Getting into debates? Getting on a crusade? Got to convince you this is the way you got to do the program. It says, for this time, Sandy, has Sandy returned? Are you seldom interested in liquor and attempted? Have you been able to recoil from it as from a hot flame? Are you reacting sanely normally? It says, we're not fighting it. We feel as though we've been placed in a position of neutrality, safe and protected. Now, if I am truly spiritually fit, and if I am truly in a position of neutrality, safe and protected, you know what that means? That means you cannot harm me. If I'm in a position of neutrality, how are you going to hurt me? What are you going to do? Steal my truck? Go ahead, take it. God's just going to give me another one. You want my money? Follow me. Follow me outside of the meeting, you know, where it's dark, and I go out to my truck and pull out a knife or a gun and say, I want your money. I say, okay, here, take it. Why? Because I'm safe and protected. God's just going to give me more. I can go anywhere. I've been to places that people have told me not to go. Let's take it to the extreme. Let's say you get really resentful at me and you decide you want to kill me, bring it on. I'm just going to a better place. That's what being safe and protected means. It means I'm no longer living in fear. That doesn't mean I don't experience fear. I'm not driven by fear anymore, because I've become clear as a result of following the recipe in this book that I'm a spiritual being with a human condition, which means I'm going to have human reactions. I'm going to experience sadness, grief, anger, disappointment, so on and so forth. But that's natural and normal for me. Next paragraph. It's easy to let up on the spiritual program of action and rest on our laurels. Here the authors are emphasizing that this is about action. We're headed for trouble if we do, for alcohol is a subtle foe. We are not cured of alcoholism. What we really have is a daily reprieve contingent on the maintenance of our spiritual condition. Every day is a day when we must carry the vision of God's will into all of our activities. How can I best serve thee? Thy will, not mine, be done. These are thoughts which must go with us constantly. We can exercise our willpower along this line all we wish. It is the proper use of the will. Here the authors are clearly explaining to me, to conform my will with God's is the proper use of the will. Check it out. We can exercise our willpower along this line all we wish. What line? Thy will be done, not mine. So to conform my will with His, it says it is the proper use of the will. I'm supposed to use my will, provided I'm spiritually fit, provided that I'm having a spiritual experience, provided that I've done the previous 10 steps. So I'm supposed to use my will. We're not a bunch of automatons. I'm supposed to use my brain. God gave me brains for a reason. Okay, on step 10, back there on page 84 in the second paragraph, where it says that we suggest that we continue to take personal inventory and continue to set right any new mistakes as we go along. Those of you that are willing to practice a daily 10th step, why don't you go ahead and recite that out loud with me? Starting with the second line in the second paragraph on page 84. So paragraph 2, second line, page 84. You ready? We continue to take personal inventory and continue to set right any new mistakes as we go along. Congratulations. All right, we've completed step 10. So let's flip back to page 59 so we can read step 11. Sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood Him, praying only for knowledge of His will for us and the power to carry that out. Okay, back here on page 85, paragraph 2, page 85, paragraph 2. It says, much has already been said about receiving strength, inspiration, and direction from Him who has all knowledge and power. Notice the authors don't say that He has a lot of knowledge and power. It says He has all knowledge and power. Now, if I have a resource available to me that has all knowledge and power, what would be the best place to go for direction? That source. Exactly. You know what I find really ironic in these rooms? And I have had this experience so many times. The very thing that has caused me more difficulty and pain and suffering has been my own head. And you know what's really interesting about that? I get a problem. You know the first place I go for a solution is my head. Now, is that insane or what? The thing that caused me more suffering and pain and humiliation when I came into these rooms, the old ideas, beliefs, and attitudes and perceptions that simply did not work, that is the first place I go for a solution when I have a problem. So, if I'm truly self-delusional, we read that, didn't we? Back in the second and the third step, that we are driven by 100 forms of fear, self-delusion, self-pity, and self-seeking. Correct? So if I'm truly driven by self-delusion, how am I going to know if I'm self-deluded? I'm not going to know. That's like going to a fish and asking it, what is water? The fish will say, well, you know, it's everywhere. Think about the weight of that statement. If I'm self-delusional, how am I going to know if I'm self-deluded? I'm not going to know. That's why it's absolutely essential that this alcoholic maintain the strict disciplines of 10, 11, and 12. Can I rely on my interpretation, my perception of my own experience? Maybe I need other people. Maybe I need access to a God of my understanding so that I can seek this knowledge and power. Okay, then the author is going to say, if we have... there's that word again. If we have carefully... doesn't say if we follow directions. If we have carefully follow directions. We have begun to sense the flow of His Spirit into us. What a promise. To some extent, we have become God-conscious. We have begun to develop this vital sixth sense. But we must go further, and that means more action. Now, how many of you have gone to meetings and you've heard somebody speak and they picked a topic? I'd like to hear your experience with your sixth sense. It's right there in the book. I mean, the authors are telling us we have begun to develop this vital. Do you know what vital means? Essential for life. So am I going to be able to live and survive? I'm not talking about not drinking. I'm talking about living here. I'm talking about being free. Being free from my own mind, my own fears, inadequacy, self-doubts, etc., etc., etc. This vital sixth sense. So this sixth sense is absolutely essential for my life and sobriety. I'm encouraging all of you that are experiencing this vital sixth sense that you take that back to your meetings and start talking about it. Start sharing with people your own experience with your vital sixth sense. But we must go further, and that means more action. My 20 years of sobriety is not going to keep me spiritually fit. Now, the truth is, I don't want to do these disciplines. I would love to be able to sit home with my 20 years of sobriety and flip the old, from channel to channel and drink my Sprite and be spiritually fit. I would love to be able to do that. But that's not what my experience shows me. Am I willing to do the disciplines? Yes. Why do I do them? A couple of reasons. Not because I'm a truth seeker. There are no truth seekers in Alcoholics Anonymous. We're comfort seekers. That's why I maintain the disciplines. Because I enjoy the comfort, the peace of mind, the serenity, the freedom, the reprieve from alcohol. Being in a position of neutrality, safe and protected. That's why I do the disciplines on a regular basis. Not because I want to do them. It's because I enjoy feeling comfort. And that's what these disciplines do for me. Let's read on. Step 11 suggests prayer and meditation. We shouldn't be shy on this matter of prayer. Better men than we are using it constantly. It works if we have the proper attitude and work at it. That is what is most important about prayer and meditation, is that I have the proper attitude and I'm willing to work at it. It would be easy to be vague about this matter, yet we believe we can make some definite and valuable suggestions. Here is where the authors very clearly describe the evening review, and they give us a hint. Now remember, we are at step 11, correct? In the book, right? And then it says in the very next paragraph, when we retire at night. That's a clue. So if I'm going to retire at night, and these are the questions I'm going to ask myself in my evening review. I'm going to ask the same four questions that I ask myself as I go through the day, as I go along in step 10. Were we resentful, selfish, dishonest, or afraid? There's a question mark. That means it's a stop sign. I'm going to stop and I'm going to answer those questions. Do we owe an apology? There's another question mark. Have we kept something to ourselves which should be discussed with another person at once? Another question mark. Were we kind and loving toward all? Another question mark. What could we have done better? Another question mark. Were we thinking of ourselves most of the time? Or were we thinking of what we could do for others or what we could pack into the stream of life? That does not mean do as much as you possibly can and complete as many tasks as possible. That has not been my understanding of pack as much as I can into the stream of life. What I'm hearing from that is, where was I helpful? Who did I help? But we must be careful not to drift into worry, remorse, or morbid reflection. Here's the warning. You know, we're not here there to beat ourselves up. Simply do a constructive review of my day. For that would diminish our usefulness to others. So, you see, I'm not useful to other people. I'm just simply sitting there beating myself up. I'm simply reviewing my day per these questions. Okay, here are the instructions. After I do my review, the authors are asking me to do two things in the next sentence. After making our review, we ask, that sounds like a prayer, doesn't it? We ask God's forgiveness. In other words, you know, yeah, I was thinking mostly of myself today. God, please forgive me for doing so. No, I wasn't kind and loving towards all. Please forgive me. And then there's that word and, which means in addition to. That means I'm going to do something in addition to prayer. Inquire what corrective measures should be taken. So if I'm going to inquire what corrective measures should be taken, that implies I'm going to listen. In other words, after I do my evening review, I'm going to pray and meditate. We talked about that last week. How essential it is for me to meditate in addition to pray. You see, if all I'm doing is praying, I'm not completing step 11 in its entirety. Notice the wording of step 11. It doesn't say sought through prayer to improve my conscious contact. So you see, if all I'm doing is praying and not meditating, am I going to improve my relationship with God? Am I going to receive the knowledge of His will and the power to carry it out? My experience has been no. If my friend Scott here calls me up and invites me to his house for a party, and I hang up the phone before I receive directions, I'm not going to know which way to go to get there. That's what prayer without meditation is like. I've created a lot of unmanageability in my life and sobriety as a result of not meditating on something, but rather praying. I had made decisions based on self, which later placed me in a position to be hurt. That's how essential it is for me to practice daily meditation. So isn't this beautiful? They're giving us a specific outline of how to do evening review, and they're giving me instructions to pray and meditate when I finish my evening review. Next paragraph. They show us how to do morning meditation. They give us a clue when to do it in the first two words. On awakening. On awakening, let us think about the 24 hours ahead. We consider our plans for the day. Before we begin, we say a prayer. It says, we ask, there's a prayer. We ask God to direct our thinking, especially asking that it be divorced from self-pity, dishonest, or self-seeking motives. Under these conditions, we can employ our mental faculties. Here, the authors are implying we are supposed to use our brains. Employ our mental faculties with assurance, for after all, God gave us brains to use. Our thought life will be placed on a much higher plane when our thinking is cleared of wrong motives. After step 9, you may notice that the authors have made a shift. 4 through 9 is about conduct. It's about where I was wrong, where I've caused harm, where I've been selfish, where I've been self-seeking, where I've been dishonest, etc., etc. Now the authors have moved into the thought life. After all, it does say on page 23 that the main problem of the alcoholic centers in his mind rather than in his body. Isn't that correct? So what needs more attention? My mind. It's the main problem. So here the authors have made a shift. Now they're shifting into, let's concentrate on our thought life. Our thought life will be placed on a much higher plane when our thinking is cleared of wrong motives. This helps me to address the self-delusion. In thinking about our day, we may face indecision. We may not be able to determine which course to take. Here, we ask, there's another prayer, God for inspiration, an intuitive thought, or a decision. We relax and take it easy. We don't struggle. We are often surprised how the right answers come after we have tried this for a while. Notice that the authors are not instructing me to ask God to keep me sober. If I truly believed, if I truly conceded to my innermost self that I have no power over alcohol, and there's absolutely nothing I can do to keep me sober, and I'm sober, and I've come to believe in a power greater than myself, and I made a decision to give my life to that, what's keeping me sober? Is it me? Is it that relationship? Is it work? Maybe it's your income. That has not been my experience. So, if I've applied those principles, if I've followed that recipe in this book up to this point, and God is keeping me sober, why do I need to go to Him and ask Him to keep me sober? Consider this for a moment. My wife is in the kitchen and she's washing dishes. And I go in and I say, Jan, would you wash the dishes, please? She's likely to frown at me. I'm certain she will frown. She's going to give me that look like, I'm already doing it. Why are you asking me to do something I'm already doing? You see, I fell victim to that for a long time in the time I was bouncing in and out of these rooms. Yes, I ask God to keep me sober every day. To my knowledge, this book doesn't say anything about not drinking one day at a time. To say that I am not going to drink one day at a time implies that I still have some reservation. That has been my experience with relapse. I hear that from relapsers a lot. Yeah, I'm asking God to keep me sober day at a time. Every morning I ask Him to keep me sober. Why? He's already doing it. They're instructing me to follow directions, a plan of action, to direct my thinking. Let's go ahead and check that out. Let's see what the books have to say about it. Okay. Here we go. Turn to page 33. Page 33, paragraph 1, line 9. Page 33, paragraph 1, line 9. If we are planning to stop drinking, there must be no reservation of any kind, nor any lurking notion that someday we will be immune to alcohol. No reservation. I'm going to jump ahead here just to illustrate a point. Here we go. Page 90, paragraph 3. Page 90, paragraph 3, line 6. That's line 6. Then let his family or a friend ask him if he wants to quit for good and if he would go to any extreme to do so. You see, what happened to me in that period of time that I was bouncing in and out of these rooms and couldn't stay sober was that I was not willing to quit for good. I was not willing to go to God and ask Him to remove it for good. Now, to say that I'm willing to give it up for good does not imply that I have power to keep me sober. What that does imply is I'm willing to go to any length to stay sober. That means I'm going to resort to any spiritual principle I possibly can in order to not drink. Because I don't have the power to keep me sober. So that means I need to call on the power from a God of my understanding. If you're having resistance to this, I simply ask you to consider if you have had that experience. Without exception, every time I go to a meeting, go to a roundup, convention, and I hear a speaker say something that I have resistance to, most of the time it is because I have not experienced it. When I heard people say things like they felt safe and protected, they were in a position of neutrality, that they stopped fighting everybody and everything. I had resistance to that. You know why? Because I never had the experience. How many people in here can tell me about bungee jumping? I have experience with bungee jumping. So what can you tell me about bungee jumping? Nothing. You have nothing to offer me about bungee jumping because you have no experience with it. You can share a lot of opinions, a lot of ideas, a lot of perceptions, but do you have any experience with it? I have some personal experience with that. I know what it's like. I wouldn't do it again. One time was enough for me, but it was a positive experience. I'm not going to go into that right now. But the point I'm trying to make, you know, in early sobriety, I found it necessary to ask God to help me stay sober because I had not had a spiritual awakening yet. I had not dialed into God's power. See, that's why it's absolutely essential that we be taken through these steps as quickly as possible. See, I'm the real alcoholic that they talk about on page 21. Given sufficient reason isn't going to keep me sober. I need to get to the power, and I need to get to it now. Now. It has been my experience. You cannot take anybody through these steps too quickly. However, you can take them through too slowly. Maybe that has something to do with the decreased success rate within the rooms of our meetings. My God, how do these guys have a 75 to 93% success rate, especially in the Cleveland-Akron area? What were they doing that we're not doing? Give this some serious thought for a moment. Medicine has made major advancements since 1939, 1944. There are treatment centers. They didn't have treatment centers then. They had drying out hospitals where they detox people. Psychology has made a lot of advancements since then. And yet the success rate in AA is lower today than it was then, and they had fewer resources. But the resources that were available to the alcoholics in 1944 are the same resources that are available to us today. And it's called the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. It's called the spiritual principles that are contained within the first 103 pages, giving me the instructions on how to do the 12 steps. Before we get into the promises, which is at the top of page 87, the promises of prayer and meditation, I'll share with you what I personally do. I don't ask God to keep me sober. He's already doing it. Keep in mind, I have to do my part. So basically what I do is this. I follow the instructions on this page. The first thing to do is I ask God to direct my thinking, especially that it would be divorce and self-pity, dishonest, or self-seeking motives. Then I say another prayer. I ask for inspiration, a tutor thought, or decision today. Then I ask God to help me to relax, take it easy, and not struggle. And that's when I move into my meditation for listening. And that's when I ask, what would you have me be today? Today, the guidance that I receive is rather simple. I typically receive guidance like, enjoy yourself today. Be kind and patient with other people. Listen. If you will practice this prayer and meditation, I can guarantee you, your life will change in a relatively short period of time. Try not to misunderstand me. I'm not saying that sobriety is solely contingent on prayer and meditation. I need to practice all the principles, not just those. But those have been very instrumental in my life. And as I stated last week, there's no right way to meditate, and there's no wrong way. What you need to do is find a way that works for you. Let's look at the promises. This is what used to be the hunch or the occasional inspiration. Here they are instructing us to be patient. Gradually becomes a working part of the mind. Once again, notice the authors are putting emphasis on the thought life. Being still inexperienced and having just made conscious contact with God, it is not probable that we are going to be inspired at all times. So I'm not inspired at all times. I tell myself, oh, it's not working. Remember what we read at the beginning of this. It works if we have the proper attitude and work at it. We might pay for this presumption and all sorts of absurd actions and ideas. Nevertheless, here's the thought life again. We find that our thinking will, as time passes, be more and more on the plane of inspiration. We come to rely upon it. Isn't that beautiful? My thinking's going to change. They're telling me, be patient. I'm not going to be inspired at all times. Now I'm going to finish prayer and meditation. Then we're going to take more action. In the next paragraph, we usually conclude the period of meditation with a prayer. So I'm going to pray, meditate, pray in the morning. That we be shown all through the day what our next step is to be. That we be given whatever we need to take care of such problems. We ask, here's a prayer. We ask especially for freedom from self-will. And we're careful to make no requests for ourselves only. We may ask for ourselves, however, if others will be helped. We are careful never to pray for our own selfish ends. Many of us have wasted a lot of time doing that, and it doesn't work. You can easily see why. That's one of the things I love about steps 10, 11. They guarantee that I'm going to make mistakes. That's why I need those bookends. Isn't that beautiful? I got two beautiful bookends. I have a bookend in the morning where I'm going to do prayer, meditation, prayer. I'm going to do a daily 10-step during the day as I go along. And at night, I'm going to do evening review, and then I'm going to do prayer and meditation when I finish. This has been my experience. I will only experience one of two things within the rooms of AA. I'm either getting better or I'm getting worse. There is no in between. No one, to my knowledge, has ever coasted uphill. It's real easy to spot people who are doing these disciplines. They don't take themselves so seriously. They seem to enjoy life much more fully. They laugh more. They make fun of themselves. You know why it's important for us to not take ourselves seriously? Because we are the joke. We are it. We are the joke. That's why I can't take myself seriously. Another reason is you're not going to. During the week, I asked you to consider doing the written meditation exercise where you write down the guidance that you receive during meditation and then test it against the four absolutes. I'm asking for any volunteers, anybody who would be willing to share the guidance that they received this week. I understand that this is a personal matter in two-way communication with the God of your understanding. I'm hoping those of you that did do it would be willing to come forward and share with us the guidance you received from God in order to show yourself and other people that guidance does come during meditation. Do I have any volunteers? Come on up.
My name is Joseph, and I'm an alcoholic addict. Very grateful to be alive today. I had the most major and profound contact with my higher power this past week. I've been a sober member of AA for a little over 7 months now. My father's coming out to visit me from New York, and him and his wife asked me to go up to Las Vegas for the weekend with a bunch of my uncles and so forth. And in this meditation this morning, it came to me out of nowhere that I wasn't ready to go to Las Vegas. And so I went right to the four, absolutes. Then I had to think about my son, who has been asking me, twice a week, when am I coming home to see him? So I had to say to myself, if I go to Las Vegas, I love to gamble and I love women, and I'm going to spend a lot of money that I don't really have, and I'd really like to go see my son. So that was my unselfish thing from God. And I had to be honest with my father and his girlfriend also that, maybe it wasn't the right time for me to go there. Will this choice bring me happiness, or will it bring others around me happiness? And I said, yes, this is going to bring me happiness, and it's going to bring others around me happiness by me not going there. And I got a lot of comfort out of this decision. And that's the most important thing, I think, because, I was delusional. I'm very delusional. I realize that, and I'm just really grateful to be here, and thank you for listening.
That's wonderful. Anyone else? Come on up.
Well, I didn't. My name's Monica. I'm an alcoholic. But I've been an investment manager for 20 years, managing money. I define myself as a portfolio manager, a good wife, a good mother, and an athlete, and right now I'm none of those, so I'm lost. And so when I meditate, I started swirling around and thinking negative that what happened to me, where am I? And it took me a long time. I mean, it took about the fifth or sixth day, and I decided to do a little bit each day, two or three times a day, rather than try and meditate, for 30 minutes, because I just couldn't sit still for that long. Meditating, it finally came to me that maybe maybe after 20 years of doing what I'm doing, maybe I'm not supposed to do that anymore. Maybe there's something more important for me to do. And I think it's step 12. I mean, I really think it is. Now, just searching, but I know that I actually look forward to the two or three times during the day just to quiet, quiet my mind. And I really look forward to it. In fact, I get a little cranky if I, can't. Because it's the only time I allow myself to lay down on the bed and don't worry about anything. You know, don't worry about my daughter. Don't worry about, money is another issue. I may have to file bankruptcy. The bills, I can't seem to sit and do my own bills. I mean, I'm a financial manager 20 years, and I'm a financial wreck. the meditation helps you listen. And an interesting thing, because I'm so numbers-oriented, an interesting thing came to me in one of those times you called in between the racing times. I can't remember what you called it, but an image of a very creative bracelet that I will make for my daughter, and her name is Morgan. And so since we're both M's, the M's are going to be, connected. And, I've never been creative. I don't have a creative bone really in my body. Art, I can't do. But this real creative side came to me. And I thought that was interesting because I saw something in me that in the last 20 years, I didn't think existed, actually. So I'm learning, and I'm trying my best to work the steps. So, with that, I'll pass.
I'd like to thank those of you who are willing to share with us the guidance that you receive from God. Step 12. Having had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, we've tried to carry this message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs. The first part implies having had a spiritual awakening as the result. It doesn't say a result. It says the result of these steps. The second part is we try to carry this message to alcoholics. And the third part is to practice these principles in all our affairs. You see, what I've discovered is that the real work is step 12. You see, what the steps do is they prepare me to do the real work. And that's what we're going to talk about today. There's a chapter 7, beginning on page 89, which is entirely devoted to working with others. Numerous times through the years I've heard people say, I really wish we had some literature on sponsorship. We have a whole chapter on sponsorship. It's called Working with Others. What I love about this chapter is that the authors give me specific, clear-cut directions. What to say, what not to say, what to do, what not to do, when to do it, when not to do it. If you haven't read this chapter, I would strongly encourage you to do so. We're going to cover some of the highlights of this. Let's start with page 89, paragraph 1. Page 89, paragraph 1. Practical experience shows that nothing will so much ensure immunity from drinking as intensive work with other alcoholics. So maybe it's essential that I work with other people. Page 90, paragraph 1. Page 90, paragraph 1. When you discover a prospect for Alcoholics Anonymous, find out all you can about him. In other words, let him talk. Let her talk. Find out who it is you're dealing with. What this does for me is gives me some perspective, which direction to take. If he does not want to stop drinking, don't waste time trying to persuade him. It's a waste of time to work with someone who's not willing to work with you. Because when I do that, I'm depriving another alcoholic and I am depriving me. Okay, paragraph 2, page 90. if there is any indication that he wants to stop, have a good talk with the person most interested in him, usually his wife. Get an idea of his behavior, his problems, his background, the seriousness of his condition, and his religious leanings. You need this information to put yourself in his place, to see how you would like him to approach you if the tables were turned. Once again, we want to get as much information as we can about the person. Next paragraph, six lines down. Then let his family or friend ask him if he wants to quit for good and if he would go to any extreme to do so. How many people in here want to quit for good? Are you willing to go to any extreme to do so? Page 91, paragraph 3. Page 91, paragraph 3. See your man alone, if possible, at first engage in general conversation. After a while, turn the talk to some phase of drinking. Tell him about your drinking habits, symptoms, and experiences to encourage him to speak of himself. If we're encouraging him to speak, that means we're going to listen. We're not going to sit down and preach to the person and tell him, this is what you need to do. If he wishes to talk, let him do so. You will thus get a better idea of how you ought to proceed. If he is not communicative, give him a sketch of your drinking career up to the time you quit. This is very important. But say nothing for the moment of how that was accomplished. If he is in a serious mood, dwell on the troubles liquor has caused you, being careful not to moralize or lecture. If his mood is light, tell him human stories of your escapades. Get him to tell some of his. When he sees you know all about the drinking game, commence to describe yourself as an alcoholic. Tell him how baffled you were, how you finally learned that you were sick. Give him an account of the struggles you made to stop. Show him the mental twist which leads to the first drink of a spree. We suggest you do this as we have done it in the chapter on alcoholism. If he is alcoholic, he will understand you at once. He will match your mental inconsistencies with some of his own. If you are satisfied that he is a real alcoholic, begin to dwell on the hopeless feature of the malady. Show him from your own experience. That's what we stick to, our own experience. How the queer mental condition surrounding that first drink prevents normal functioning of the willpower. Don't at this stage refer to this book unless he has seen it and wishes to discuss it. And be careful not to brand him as an alcoholic. Let him draw his own conclusion. So when I work with new guys, I go into it not assuming that they're alcoholic. What I do is I go into it giving them the dignity of finding the truth about their experience. Next paragraph, page 92, which is paragraph 2. Continue to speak of alcoholism as an illness, a fatal malady. Talk about the conditions of body and mind which accompany it. Keep his attention focused mainly on your personal experience. That's why I'm there, to share my experience, not my opinions, not my ideas, not what church he should go to, who he should be married to or not be married to, what job he should have. That's none of my business. Page 93, third line from the top. Now, notice, before we read this, up to this point, basically all we've done is listen. I'm swapping experiences with him. I'm sharing some of my mental inconsistencies, the mental obsession, some of the things that occurred to me when I was drinking. And then they tell us this, third line from the top of page 93. Tell me exactly what happened to you. Stress the spiritual feature freely. So see, up to this point, I'm not going to even mention it. If the man be agnostic or atheist, make it emphatic that he does not have to agree with your conception of God. He can choose any conception he likes, provided it makes sense to him. So you see, his understanding of God doesn't have to make sense to me. What's most important is that it makes sense to him. The main thing is that he be willing to believe in a power greater than himself and that he live by spiritual principles. Okay, turn to page 95, paragraph 2. Page 95, paragraph 2. If he is not interested in your solution, if he expects you to act only as a banker for his financial difficulties or a nurse for his sprees, you may have to drop him until he changes his mind. I'm not a banker. I'm not a hotel. I'm there to share my experience, strength, and hope with him. Page 96, paragraph 1. Page 96, paragraph 1. Do not be discouraged if your prospect does not respond at once. Search out another alcoholic and try again. You are sure to find someone desperate enough to accept with eagerness what you offer. We find it a waste of time to keep chasing a man who cannot or will not work with you. If you leave such a person alone, he may soon become convinced that he cannot recover by himself. To spend too much time on anyone's situation is to deny some other alcoholic an opportunity to live and be happy. Sounds like Bill Wilson. First 12 guys that he worked with didn't stay sober. He was disappointed. He went back to his wife, Lois, and said, you know, I've been talking to these drunks and none of them are staying sober. She said, well, you are. So you see, when I work with others, it does not matter whether they stay sober. It does not matter if they follow through. It does not matter if they call. If they're not willing to work with me, I find another person. Notice also, it doesn't say anywhere in this book, to my knowledge, that I go to meetings and I kick back and I wait for the newcomer to come to me. Where would this program be if Bill Wilson and Dr. Bob did that? If they sat home and said, you know, nope, the phone hasn't rang. They sought them out. Have you ever noticed newcomers in meetings raising their hands and saying, hi, my name's John, I'm an alcoholic, and I need a sponsor. I need to work with somebody. You know what I do? When they ask for, are there any other AA announcements, I raise my hand. Hi, I'm Paul, I'm an alcoholic, and I need to work with somebody and take them through the steps. So if there's anyone here that needs to be taken through the steps, please see me after the meeting. I have a responsibility to be available to the newcomer. That means I'm not going to wait for them to come to me. I'm simply sharing with you what I was taught to do by my first sponsor. So when I'm at a meeting, there might be 10 people there that I want a hug from that I'm close to. But if there are newcomers there and they stand up, I'm going to ask them, do you have a sponsor? And if they say no, I don't ask them if they want one. That's what my book says. I don't ask them if they want a sponsor. I sign myself. I say, well, you got one now. I'm your sponsor. Well, what if I don't want you to be my sponsor? Well, then go get another one. But the point is, I'm taking responsibility for carrying the message of hope to the alcoholic. Hey, let's go grab some coffee. You open to doing that? Then we sit down, and I do as outlined in this book. Sit down and get more information from the person. Find out who it is I'm dealing with. Say, I don't know about the rest of you. I want to stay sober. I want to be free. I cannot be free by not working with others. My 20 years of sobriety will not keep me sober. Sobriety does not keep me sober. That's simply a gift. That gift isn't going to keep me sober. Remember, I'm a real alcoholic. I can't survive on the food I received yesterday. I need new spiritual food today. And I can't rely on what I did yesterday to maintain what I'm experiencing today. Here's something to consider. What would happen to AA if everybody in AA did sobriety the way you're doing it today? What would happen to AA if everybody in AA was doing sobriety the way you're doing it today? I have a responsibility when I go to meetings today to carry a message of hope. What that means is this. I am not there to talk about my problems. That's what sponsors are for. That's what coffee before the meeting, coffee after the meeting is for. Stop and think about it. You go to a meeting, you dump, you whine, you complain. You got some new person in there. Do you think that person wants to come back? The point I'm trying to make is this. Those of us that have gone through the steps and have had a spiritual awakening, we have a responsibility to carry hope to the meetings. So when that newcomer comes in and he hears hope, he or she wants to return to that meeting. I'm coming back to this meeting. I heard a lot of hope. Page 97, paragraph 1, line 2. Page 97, paragraph 1, line 2. Helping others is the foundation stone of your recovery. A kindly act once in a while isn't enough. You have to act the Good Samaritan every day if need be. It may mean the loss of many nights' sleep, great interference with your pleasures, interruptions to your business. So ask yourself, do I have a foundation stone? Am I working with others? Am I helping other people? Page 98, paragraph 1, line 8. Page 98, paragraph 1, line 8. Some of us have taken very hard knocks to learn this truth. Job or no job, wife or no job. We simply do not stop drinking, so long as we place dependence upon other people ahead of dependence on God. My sobriety is not contingent on my sponsor. It's not dependent on him. It's important that I have one. It's important I maintain contact with him. Bring the idea into the consciousness of every man that he can get well regardless of anyone. The only condition is that he trusts in God and clean house. Last line on page 99. Last line on page 99. Remind the prospect that his recovery is not dependent upon people. It is dependent upon his relationship with God. Notice it does not say that it is dependent on God. It is dependent upon his relationship. Now, this is where prayer and meditation comes back in. If I'm going to have a relationship with someone, that assumes that I'm going to spend time with them. Is that correct? So if I'm going to have a relationship with my friend Michael here, that means I need to spend time with him. I need to talk to him, and I need to listen. A relationship isn't where I'm doing all the talking. That's not a relationship. A relationship involves talking and listening. Paragraph 1, page 100. Both you and the new man must walk day by day in the path of spiritual progress. If you persist, remarkable things will happen. If I persist, remarkable. When we look back, we realize that the things which came to us when we put ourselves in God's hands were better than anything we could have planned. Follow the dictates of a higher power, and you will presently live in a new and wonderful world, no matter what your present circumstances. Page 102, paragraph 2. Your job now is to be at the place where you may be of maximum helpfulness to others. So never hesitate to go anywhere if you can be helpful. So if I'm doing the work, which is working with others, I'm carrying the message, not the mess, not my opinions, not my ideas. What I've learned as a result of going through these steps on a repeated basis and continuing to work with others, that when I sponsor someone, I have only three responsibilities. Only three. Take them through the 12 steps. Tell them the truth and love them. To love them simply means let them be right where they are. It's important for me to let the guys I sponsor to let them struggle. I'm not there to repair their struggles. Which reminds me of a story of a little boy who goes out to the woods and he sees a butterfly in a cocoon struggling to get out. He decides to help the butterfly. So he pulls out his pocket knife and he opens up the cocoon so the butterfly can get all the way out. The butterfly is able to get all the way out of the cocoon and then he falls to the ground and dies. The little boy runs home and he asks his father, he says, "Daddy, Daddy, I tried to help this butterfly and he died. What happened?" And the father says, "Well, son, you know, that butterfly needed to struggle so it could develop the strength, so it could fly." I have no desire to get in the middle of someone's experience. I take the person through the steps. It's not my job to continually to go back and hound them and remind them, "Are you doing those amends?" That's not my job. This is what my sponsor did for me. He sat me down. Basically, he did how it's outlined in this book, and he got a good idea of what I would, you know, what my drinking, and of course my using was like at the time. And he asked me a couple of simple questions. He said, "Are you willing to go to any length to have a spiritual experience?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Are you willing to do everything I ask you to do with no debate?" Ooh. He said, "Well, are you willing to consider that my judgment about your life is infinitely better than yours?" After all, I've been bouncing in and out of AA for 12 years. "Yeah, but you don't understand. I've been around these rooms for a long time." That was the problem. I'd been around. I had not been in it. And you could always spot me in a meeting. You could tell I was a relapser. And you could tell that I was operating on self-will because I would say things like, "Yeah, I put together X amount of sobriety." That was the problem. I put it together. I said, "Yeah, but I've been around these rooms for a long time." He said, "Now, wait a minute." He said, "You have absolutely nothing we want. You have absolutely nothing to offer us." I said, "What do you have to offer us? Do you have any experience in living a spiritual way of life?" "Well, you know, I know something about spiritual living, you know, and it says that." I said, "Yeah." He said, "But wait a minute, do you have any experience?" "No." He said, I'll tell you what. He said, I want you to go to meetings and I want you to shut up and don't talk, because you have nothing to offer until you go through all 12 steps and you have a spiritual awakening. Then you will have something to offer. He's, by the way, he said, all that drinking you did, you know, and putting those needles in your arms and carrying those weapons and all that. He said, if we need any help in that area, we'll call on you. In the meantime, just go to meetings and listen. I'll tell you, it was tough because, you know, I had some great ideas and you people needed to hear about them. And I had a lot of ideas. But the point is, in the 12 years I was bouncing in and out of the rooms, I was going around sharing opinions on experiences I never had. You start talking about the fourth step, I'd share it. Yeah, this is what I think about the fourth step. I had no experience with it. It's like you coming up to me and trying to tell me about bungee jumping. You don't have a clue. You have no experience with it. You have experience in an area. If you have experience with making amends, I'm going to come to you and ask you. If you have experience with repairing relationships, with taking care of finances, et cetera, et cetera, I'm going to go to you. I'm going to seek you out. What he did is he took me through those steps really quick, less than 6 weeks, and he cut me loose, said, okay, I want you to start working with others. I was terrified. Afraid, oh, my God, I'm going to kill someone. No, I'm not. I had an experience. I had a spiritual awakening, and I got a lot of flack from people saying, you haven't been sober long enough. Where does it say that in our book, that we have to be sober 1 year before we start sponsoring others? Bill Wilson wasn't sober a year. Dr. Bob wasn't sober a year when he started carrying the message. The only prerequisite is that I have gone through all 12 steps and I've had a spiritual awakening. Now I have something to offer. Now I have the message. And I've had experience with sharing the mess. And it was not helpful. Sharing your experience and the solution in this book with another suffering alcoholic, you will not want to miss. Attempt to convey to you the excitement and the joy and the jubilation of sharing with another alcoholic is hard to convey if you haven't had the experience. Only the people who have done it will truly understand what it's like. It's an absolute joy to work with other alcoholics. Now, my mind doesn't always say that. I mean, I've sponsored guys through the years who, you know, who are like emotional vampires, the kind of person you put in your car and you're driving down the street and the street lights dim every time you drive under him. You know, you say, oh, God, I don't want to spend time with him because I'm going to go there and I have to listen to all this whining and then I'm going to have to turn around and call my sponsor and whine about his whining, which is something we all do. You know, and I'm on the way there and I'm thinking, geez, I want to be with this guy. You know, he's in victim posture and he's going to whine. He's going to start talking about this and, yeah, I look at my watch and think I'm going to miss that game. I'm going to have to get the score. You know, I'm going to miss out on that. You know, and I get there and invariably sometime in the middle of doing the step work, something magical happens. And I start to have gratitude and I'm thankful. And spontaneously this prayer goes off in my head that says, thank you, God. Thank you for allowing me to be here. And I walk away and my cup is full. And then next week I go through it all over again, you know. But it's from the experience. So you see, it doesn't matter what my mind tells me. It's from the experience of the transformation that I experience as a result of continuing to work with others. You see, the newcomer is the lifeblood and the old timer is the heart. And neither one can survive without the other. I need the newcomer and the newcomer needs the old timer. So you see, we're in this thing together. Kind of reminds me of an experience that I had watching the Discovery Channel. They had these buffalo. It was in Africa, these African buffalo, and they were all, this herd of them was going through a pasture. And on the perimeter of the pasture were these lions. And the lions were just laying there, not even moving a muscle. And then all of a sudden, one of the buffalo left the herd. And immediately, the lions pounced on him and killed him. And I looked at that and I thought, wow, that's just like AA. When I stick with the herd, I'm okay. But the moment I leave the herd, I'm dead meat. I'd like to welcome all of you to the fourth dimension. Before we close tonight, there are a couple of things that we're going to go over. Why don't you pull out your questionnaire that we reviewed in our first session? These were questions on beliefs in AA that we were being asked to answer true or false before and after our step work. The purpose of this is to see if there was any change in what you believe. It's entitled Questions on Beliefs in AA. Okay, true or false? If we are planning to stop drinking, all we have to do is not drink one day at a time. True or false?
False.
On page 33, it says if we are planning to stop drinking, there must be no reservation of any kind, nor any lurking notion that someday we will be immune to alcohol. Next one. Once I take the steps, I will have a partnership with my higher power.
False.
Look what it says on page 62 and 63. Let's take a look. It's telling me on page 62 and 63 that he's the principal and I'm his agent. Does that sound like a partnership? 63, they're telling me that I'm going to have a new employer. Does that sound like a partnership? If he has all the power, does that sound like a partnership? Nope. Have you ever seen that bumper sticker? God is my co-pilot. Oh, my goodness. That sounds dangerous. God is my co-pilot. If God's my co-pilot, who's driving the car? Who's in charge? Me. Uh-oh, look out. Okay. Oh, boy. Next one. Once I fully understand God, I will be free from my alcoholism.
False.
Wonder why. Let's see what it says in the book. Can I fully understand God? No. It's impossible, isn't it? For me to fully understand God is to be God. I still don't understand God. Okay. The big book is the only book I need to read. We just read that on page 87. Where the authors are suggesting that we read outside literature. Next one. It is not necessary to do step four more than once. True or false? What do you think? False. Page 71. If you have already made a decision, that's step three, and an inventory of your grosser handicaps, that's step four, you have made a good beginning. It doesn't say we're finished. There's no way I'm going to uncover everything I need to uncover that blocks me from God in one inventory. We can win the confidence of another alcoholic by relating to their experiences. Let me read it again. We can win the confidence of another alcoholic by relating to their experiences. What do you think, true or false? What do you think? They have to relate to our experience? Let's see what the book says. Page 18, if you'd like to know where the answer to this is. In the italicized part, it says, but the ex-problem drinker who has found this solution, they're talking about what? The spiritual solution. Who is properly armed with facts about himself, can generally win the entire confidence of another alcoholic in a few hours. So you see, I have to have had found a solution and being properly armed with facts about myself. Next one. Our purpose in sobriety is to get back into the mainstream of life. True or false? What is our purpose? Yeah, our real purpose is to fit ourselves to be a maximum service to God and the people about us. That's on page 77. Next one. There are many different ways you can work this program. True or false?
False.
It's really clear on page 58, the very first thing we hear and how it works in every single meeting. Rarely have we seen a person fail who has thoroughly followed our path. Path doesn't have an S on it. Next one. Our sobriety is our greatest possession. What do you think? Is our sobriety our greatest possession? Let me share with you what it says on page 124. The alcoholic's past thus becomes the principal asset of the family, and frequently it is almost the only one. Cling to the thought that in God's hands, the dark past is the great possession you have. Wow, the key to life and happiness for others. So my greatest possession is my past. It's not my sobriety. The authors of the big book encourage us to drink. True or false? What do you think? Page 31. Let's see what the authors say. Step over to the nearest bar room and try some controlled drinking. That sounds like an encouragement to me. They're encouraging me to go out and try some controlled drinking. See, their authors are trying to find out, are you really an alcoholic? Do you really have no power? Okay. Next one. Our main focus needs to be on the alcoholic, not on their family. True or false? Our main focus needs to be on the alcoholic, not on their family. Let's see what it says in the big book. On page 97, it says, though an alcoholic does not respond, there is no reason why you should neglect his family. You should continue to be friendly to them. The family should be offered your way of life. We don't hear enough of this in meetings. I've had many opportunities in sobriety to go out and work with the family when the alcoholic wasn't willing to seek a solution. So we need to be willing to offer that to the family as well. Next one. It takes a long time to recover from alcoholism. Maybe it's true. What do you think? It takes a long time to recover from alcoholism. If it took a long time, how come it didn't take Dr. Bob and Bill Wilson very long? Let's see what the book says on page 118. We do not like the thought that the contents of a book or the work of another alcoholic has accomplished in a few weeks that for which we struggled for years. Another quote, page 158. See what it says over here. On the third day, the lawyer gave his life to the care and direction of his Creator and said he was perfectly willing to do anything necessary. His wife came, scarcely daring to be hopeful, though she thought she saw something different about her husband already. Wow, he had begun to have a spiritual experience. You, in this workshop, have had personal experience. In a matter of 4 weeks, you've gone through all the 12 steps. Okay. The next one. The steps are not required. They are suggested. That's a tricky one, isn't it? Somebody said true. Well, it does say in chapter 5 that the steps are suggested, correct? Let's see what it says in another place in the book, page 25. Almost none of us like the self-searching, the leveling of our pride, the confession of shortcomings, which the process requires for its successful consummation. So if I'm going to succeed, the steps are required for me. They are not suggested. It reminds me of a story this guy was telling. He was telling me about a friend of his who conducted skydiving. And in his hangar, he had all these parachutes hanging on the wall with a big sign on the top of it pointing to the ripcord ring, saying, this ring is but suggested when you are up there. Now, is our life any less important than the person who's skydiving and has a ring that they can... It's only suggested that they pull it. Right? For this alcoholic, the steps are required, according to my own experience and the experience of the authors in this book. The next one. Going to meetings and not drinking is vital to our recovery. What do you think? Going to meetings and not drinking is vital to our recovery. Let's see what it says in Roman numeral 17. Roman numeral 17. It also indicated that strenuous work, one alcoholic with another, was vital to permanent recovery. That's at the top of Roman numeral 17, which is XVII, where the author states, it also indicated that strenuous work, one alcoholic with another, was vital to permanent recovery. That would be, in the fourth edition, that would be two later pages. The last one, our common suffering is what holds us together. True or false? What do you think? Let's see what the authors say. It says our common suffering is what holds us together. Let's see what it says in the book on page 17. The feeling of having shared in a common peril is one element in the powerful cement which binds us, but that in itself would never have held us together as we are now joined. The tremendous fact for every one of us is that we have discovered a common solution. In other words, our suffering is not what binds us together. Our suffering is what brings us together. What holds us together is the solution. Every single person in this room who has completed the 12 steps, regardless of how long you've been sober, you are now in a position to take somebody else through the steps. If you're anything like me, when my sponsor first took me through the steps, he cut me loose. Said, okay, now go out there and find somebody to work. What do you mean, find somebody to work with? I was afraid I was going to kill somebody. But you see, I had experience. I had gone through the steps. I would go to meetings, and I had got a lot of flack from people telling me, you haven't been sober long enough. Where does it say in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous that I have to be sober X amount of time in order to carry the message of hope? It doesn't say that in the book. Once again, if it's not in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, it is not Alcoholics Anonymous. I'm here to tell each and every one of you that have completed the steps, you are the ones. You are the torchbearers of this program. You are the lifeblood. The old timer is the heart. Neither one can survive without the other. We're depending on you to carry the message of hope to the new person, to carry the message of hope back to your meetings, to get active with sponsoring people. So I'm encouraging every single person in this room to come back next week for a new cycle of the Big Book Workshop. You are in a position. You are qualified to do so. You have had a spiritual experience. Has the compulsion to drink been removed for you? You're nodding yes. That means you are in a position to do so. You can't do this wrong. There is no sponsor school. You know how you learn to be a sponsor? By being one. There is no sponsor school. You don't, well, I need to wait until I'm sober a year. Really? Now, what if Dr. Bob and Bill Wilson did that? What if Bill Wilson carried the message to Dr. Bob? Dr. Bob said, how long have you been sober? He didn't care. He had a message of hope. God made a deal with me. He separated me from alcohol as a result of going through the steps. And this was the deal. Paul, I guarantee you will never, ever have to drink again, and you'll never have to live the way you were living before. And all I ask is that you carry this message of hope to another alcoholic. That's a smoking deal. For an alcoholic like me, I'm telling you, this is the best game in town right here. Nobody in this room has to ever drink again, and you don't ever have to live the way you were living before if you don't want to. I want to thank each and every one of you, and I want to thank you for allowing me to be of service, and I'm looking forward to seeing each and every one of you next Sunday for a new cycle of the Big Book Workshop so that you can come here and be of service to the new person who wants to be taken through the steps as outlined in this book so they too can have freedom. God bless you and thank you very much.